Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Moth to Flame by Joe Clifford. Narrated by Angelina Rocca. Nyctophobia. Noun. Extreme or irrational fear of the night or of darkness. The night of the protest. The rider on the plane, broadcast excerpt. Thursday, March 14th, 1991. 11:49 p.m. Lies. Bullshit. Spin. You know it, I know it. And trust me, the school board knows it. Brad Pierce was the best teacher we ever had. And they fired him. For what? For telling the truth? For challenging authority's self-serving deceptions, exposing the gross inequities of a system built to exploit us. But this is what they do, isn't it? Divide and conquer. Control. It's always about control. Get brother to hate brother. Sister to hate sister. Misinformation. Don't trust your own eyes and ears. Believe what they tell you is the truth. They want you to travel down the road they've paved. The one that leads to profits for them and ends in subjugation for us. They want to keep us caged like rats spinning wheels, fueling their power trip. The machination of oppression. The ones in control have been pulling this crap since the dawn of civilization. They isolate, subjugate, legislate, facilitate an economic divide favoring the ruling class, rendering a few royalty, the rest of us servants. And they keep us down by force-feeding propaganda, fattening us up like ducks so they can spread our engorged livers on their gold-dusted bread. Work us to the bone. Break our backs. Bleed us dry. Toss the carcass. There's plenty more waiting to take their turn. Mr. Pierce confronted our perceptions, pulled back the curtain to uncover the master's puppet strings. We are meant for more than punching clocks, wasting our best years in boxes or factories. We are meant to live. Right now, if they have their way, we're gonna die. Look at what's going on half a globe away. Iraq, man. Dropping bombs to keep the price of oil down and their stock options up. I'm telling you, this war isn't over. It's going to rage on and on. It's our generation's Vietnam. How long before we get sent overseas? Left in the desert to risk our lives to protect their interests? This school doesn't foster independent thinking. They choose the curriculum, pick the books, redacted and chock full of revisionist history. Like Mr. Pierce said, you can't sell out if you never buy in. And what did he get for dropping that knowledge? Fired, that's what. But I'm telling you, man, we've got them scared. We've started a movement. The Paso Ardo Police Department, the FCC and FBI are listening in on this right now. Hello, you bastards. They're closing in. Trying to identify me. And they will catch me. Because I'm gonna let them. Sometimes winning means surrender. We only have a few minutes. Tonight, I'm sorry to say, our time together comes to an end. Right now, the pigs are triangulating this roving signal, ready to slap on the cuffs. Then what? No clue. What's the prison sentence in this country for telling the truth? Ask Leonard Peltier. Ask Mumia Abu-Jamal. Ask Brad Pierce. Brad Pierce was more than a 12th grade English teacher. He was an inspiration. The one person who had the balls to rage against the machine. To tell it like it is, and not regurgitate homogenized agendas. Thanksgiving and the 4th of July are myths. We didn't eat turkey with the Indians. We slaughtered them. This land isn't our land. It's their land. No one told me about Wounded Knee until Mr. Pierce. 4th of July? More blood and bullshit. When fascism comes, Brad said, it will be wrapped in the flag and carrying a cross. God? The only God they worship is the almighty dollar. Brad was the one adult who gave it to us straight. He talked to us like regular people and not little kids. But he's gone now. This is our fight. We will not sit down. We will not shut up. We will rise up and tell Principal Scheinbaum and the rest of the school board that no, we will not respect their decision to fall in line and salute their flag. They had their time. Now it's ours. It's almost midnight. The feds are en route. This radio broadcast was never about me. It was never about Mr. Pierce. It was about all of us. A unified scene fighting together. You hear that, man? The sirens? Right on cue. They got me surrounded. They want me to come out with my hands up, like a goddamn movie. I'm pulling over. It's been an honor to be your captain, and I am proud to go down with this ship. Let this be our reminder that we can all be something bigger. Ride her out. The morning of the disappearance. Friday, March 15th, 1991. 1:12 a.m. It had been over an hour since the Paso Ardo PD and feds arrived in Soledad Gorge. Squad cars screeching, followed by several unmarked sedans. Men in dark suits and darker sunglasses at night. All to take down the rider. Jess Barrett never got to see who the rider was. The mystery man behind the garbled, disguised voice. The one who helped start a revolution. The scene, pure chaos. Everyone running in different directions, screaming, bullhorn blasting, shouting for the riot crowd to disperse. Stop where you are. Every one of you punks is in trouble. You are going to jail. Yeah, right. Like they are piling 100 students from the privileged valley into the back of the prison bus. The class of 91 should have stood their ground, fought like Ryder had rallied them to do. But seeing those flashing blue and red lights was scary. Talking tough is harder to do when you're staring down a gun. Jess had drunk more than she'd intended. She wasn't much of a drinker. Had a few pills. This night was a big deal. A celebration. A declaration. A creed. Hearts were also broken. Jess had been more optimistic before the fight with Cam. She and Cam never really dated. They hooked up a few times. Okay, it was more than that. They had feelings for each other. Strong feelings. She was downplaying their relationship because she didn't want to be the bad guy. It's not you, it's me. Empty excuses. She hadn't been totally wasted, but after their fight, she wanted to be numb, obliterated. Mixing meds and hard liquor was never a good idea. Turned out worse than that. Can you love more than one person? Jess was pretty sure she did. Cam was special. He was also a boy. A cute, interesting boy. That didn't compare to a man. Cam was more mature than any other person her age. Being the chief of police's son, as well as the only black student at Paso Ardo High, Cam had to deal with shit Jess couldn't imagine. Nothing seemed to rattle Cam. He was smart, strong, self-secure. And now Jess was thinking maybe she'd made the wrong choice. Or maybe she didn't love anyone. And recent decisions had been a chain reaction of chemical interaction, sexual attraction, longing, desire, pure wanton animalistic lust. What did it matter now? Neither one was here. She missed him so much. How he smelled. How intelligent and sophisticated he could be. Society said it was wrong. She heard the whispers. In the hall. Tonight, on the hillside. Saw the greasy smirk on Jeremiah's face when he palmed her the pills. In a way, she was relieved. She wanted people to know the truth. The weight of secrets drag you down and broken hearts are as heavy as stone. What did she hope to accomplish tonight? What had any of them hoped to accomplish? She had time to mull this over now, as the sounds of law and chaos faded behind her. Jess stumbled in the darkness, unsteady on shaky legs. The crunch of dry brush and dead twigs beneath her feet, echoing throughout the valley. With each step, she distanced herself further from the bedlam. Walk turning to a jog to a sprint. The night dipped colder, her skin clammy. She didn't stop running until she was far away and alone. Why had she run in the opposite direction from everyone else? Because Jess Barrett wasn't a sheep. She listened to her own beat, made her own rules, and she always would. Jess swigged the rest of the bourbon, washing down the remaining pills. She planned on taking one. She ended up taking all four. Bourbon mixed with the meds, and the rush hit her all at once. It was beautiful. She could smell the far-off citrus orchards, the air piquant with spritzed orange and lemons, a kiss of sunshine in the dark valley in the dead of night. The hillsides blazed with yellow mustards and red brome juxtaposed against blacks so black they appeared blue. The shrubs on the prairie, the wild grasses of the valley. Jess's run slowed to a walk. She walked a long way. When Jess heard crunching leaves and cracking twigs, she thought the disturbance came from her steps. Time was playing with her, like a recording on a half-second delay, the opening to a Pink Floyd song. Until she looked down and realized she had moved. Must be a rabbit or other woodland creature. A squirrel skittering around a tree. No. Whatever was out there was bigger, heavier, deadlier. A disruption of ground cover unearthed a slinking beast stalking its prey. The movement too methodical. A coyote, bobcat, mountain lion. The valley was filled with terrifying creatures that hunted at night. She waited for yellow eyes piercing the dark. The sharp claws that would tear her limb to limb. Could she outrun it? Fight it off? Jess was tall, but slim. She didn't like her chances against jagged incisors. Through wobbly eyes, Jess scanned the forest floor, trying to focus enough to find a sharp stick. She reached in her pocket, extracted her house keys, slipping the metal spikes between her knuckled fist. Then the sound stopped. The beast had changed its mind. Didn't want the hassle. Had retreated. Or whatever was clocking her had its timing down and prepared to pounce. Jess spun and locked eyes. It wasn't a wild animal. The thing that stared back was far deadlier. Chapter 1. Now. Tuesday, July 19th, 2016. 4:59 p.m. The bright white lamp blazed overhead, illuminating the cold blue corpse. You can feel the presence of death, addition by subtraction. It's more than the fish belly flesh or ungodly odor. Life possesses an essence. You can feel when it's there, and you know when it's gone, a soul extracted. Chest cavity sawed open, hard bones split, cartilage cut, parted, peeled like thick plastic casing. Lydia Barrett slipped her hands into the slick slime, extracting the heart meat. She held it in her hands. The organ was more than a knotted lump of muscle, a vessel to pump and filter blood. It was a life force, a battery that had once powered a full-fledged human being. When it stopped functioning, so did we. Maybe one day modern medicine would crack the code, figure out how to get it beating again. Immortality. Until then, the dead stayed gone. When the cell buzzed in her pocket, Lydia mentally chastised herself for leaving it there in the first place. A rookie mistake. Maureen Guerin, friend, mentor, confidant, loomed nearby, studying Lydia's technique and methodology, pretending she didn't hear the iPhone's vibration. Maybe she didn't. Maureen, so engrossed in Lydia's process and procedure, unable to hide her satisfaction. Just because you stop being someone's student doesn't mean you stop learning from them. Maureen Guerin had been Lydia's life coach, in one form or another, for more than half her life. Lydia was thankful when the cell stopped droning, a temporary reprieve, only to have it immediately start up, which told her who was calling. The last person she wanted to talk to, her mother, Gloria. Lydia ignored the distraction and placed the cold meat on the scale, jotting the data, reporting numbers into the recorder. Swapping out sharp metal objects, she selected needle and thread, piercing together leathery dead flesh, sewing whole what had been torn apart. Autopsy over, the two women retreated to the adjacent room to clean up and confer behind closed doors. Beyond the big glass window, the naked dead man lay on display. Lydia peeled her gloves, snapping them in the trash with pinpoint precision. Nothing but net. Reaching in her pocket, she stealthily attempted to slide off her phone before Gloria had a chance to hit redial.
"What do you think?"
Maureen asked, hands soaping under hot water, steam rising, eyes cast askance, a casual question to mask serious inquiry. Lydia knew what Mo was doing. Her old instructor often called her in to assist with autopsies like these. There was always a rub, no different than when Lydia first began her apprenticeship. Appearance versus reality. Identify the abnormality. A test to evaluate if her former star pupil was still as sharp. This one was a big old softball.
"What?" Maureen teased. "You don't agree with the diagnosis of a heart attack?"
"We both know it wasn't a heart attack.
All the symptoms."
"Pulmonary embolism," Lydia said. "Come on, Mo. You used to try harder."
"I used to think I was prepping you to take over for me."
Maureen feigned disappointment, affecting the posture of a tired old woman. "Nice try." Lydia could only hope to look that good when she was 59. Maureen Guerin was grace and dignity personified, projecting the classic beauty of a latter-day Michelle Pfeiffer. At 38, Lydia felt exhausted, beat up, aged. "This job gets the best of us all. Except Maureen, apparently." Maureen's expression washed earnest.
"Please, reconsider."
"I like where I'm at."
"You're overqualified where you're at."
Lydia offered a wry grin. "Oh, but you meet the most interesting people." Despite being a shoo-in for the county medical examiner's office, Lydia had opted for the less glamorous and lower-paying position of coroner's investigator on the graveyard shift. The reasons for this were complicated. Or maybe that was how Lydia justified her decision to most. Of course, Maureen knew better.
"You're wasting your talents. That job is a stepping stone for recent grads, or where washouts go. I'm not saying that to be mean. I know Ward and a lot of others who would have worked the job. They're good people."
Ward Haynes was Lydia's last partner on the overnight. He was nice, borderline competent, and mailing it in until the Social Security and pension kicked in next year.
"It's an important job," Maureen continued. "A necessary one. You were meant for more. I'm offering what you trained to be. You didn't earn a medical degree to be creeping around Los Angeles at all hours of the night."
Lydia stifled a yawn. Maureen's face fell sour. "Sorry," Lydia said. "That wasn't intentional." Maureen grimaced.
"How's the insomnia?"
"I'm here, aren't I?" Lydia got enough rest before and after her shift, even if she had to cobble it together. She didn't require much sleep. 4 to 5 hours did the trick, if not always in a row. We learn to live with what we cannot rise above. Lydia made the schedule work for her. Every day she got in her jogging or yoga and was able to run errands, respond to emails, which still left time to shower, grab coffee, and make it to work on time. But rest isn't the same as sleep. It had been a while since Lydia slept well. That was if she ever did. Maureen knew the backstory, few did.
"How are the night terrors?"
"I wouldn't call them night terrors," Lydia waited. "Sometimes when I'm stressed, my dreams disturb more easily."
"And keep you from falling back to sleep?"
"I'm a light sleeper.
Underlying issues only burrow deeper.
You sound like a therapist." Lydia made sure to catch Maureen's eye. "I'm okay. I promise."
"When you follow me," Maureen said, "and I hope you will. Medical examiners work during the day."
"I am well aware."
"The assistant position is yours. Say the word, Lydia Sell buzzed, making it clear her first attempt to silence Mom had failed. She had no choice but to abandon the subterfuge, pulling the phone from her pocket. 5 missed calls, all but one from Gloria. Adjusting her thin-rimmed glasses, Lydia made sure to get it right this time, powering the damn thing off. "And how is Mom?" Maureen asked. "She hasn't grown nicer in her old age, if that's what you mean." "You know," Maureen said respectfully, "you can Google how to deal with toxic family members, and you'll get 1,000 results." Maureen reached out, grabbed Lydia's arm, a show of maternal affection, a gesture Lydia had lacked her entire life. Gloria might have been her mother, but she sure wasn't a mom. Since meeting Maureen, Lydia had been blessed. With a seat on the board, Maureen did more than offer a scholarship. Maureen Guerin had taken up the mantle of caregiver, a job she was under no obligation to shoulder. Without Mo's influence, who knows where Lydia could have ended up? Blood is blood. "She's my mother," Lydia said. "She doesn't have anyone."
"What about the old guy? Still hanging around? Holding out hope?"
Lydia laughed. Poor old Richard Fontaine. He was so in love with Gloria. Her mother had been stringing along the handyman to do free work since Lydia was a kid, back when her older sister Jessica was still alive. Richard always seemed to be lurking. He'd disappear for chunks of time, and then there he was, like he'd never left. "He's still in the picture," Lydia said. "I'm her daughter. You know how she milks that." Lydia checked the big clock on the wall. "I owe her a visit." She grabbed her windbreaker off the rack, scrunching it up. "Promised I'd head over before my shift.
Want some company?"
"You don't have to do that."
"I know," Maureen smiled. "Purely selfish reasons. I could use more time with my favorite protege. Besides," she added, "we both know your mother doesn't cook, and you need to eat."
"Please don't say I'm getting too skinny." Maureen laughed.
"There's a great Vietnamese place on the way. Terrific pho. My treat."
"I won't say no." Lydia relished the buffer when it came to dealing with her mother. "If you promise to ease up on the hard sell." Maureen blessed herself in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, which earned a courtesy chuckle. Neither was a believer. Students of science, each favored the quantifiable over the supernatural. The drive back home to Paso Ardo offered pleasant views of the SoCal landscape. Evening settling, horizon of fiery auburn as the sun bobbed behind the hills. Maureen and Lydia had known each other long enough that they didn't need to fill empty spaces with meaningless chatter. The shared company of mutual silence, Lydia appreciated Mo's tutelage. What she told Maureen outside the autopsy room was true. She did plan on working for the medical examiner's office. Someday. Lydia was more than qualified, having graduated top of her class, the recipient of countless awards and commendations. Bouts of insomnia aside, Lydia could adapt to sleeping during the night same as anyone. Yes, she suffered from nyctophobia, a fear of the night. A mild form. Situational, therapists suggested, stemming from the loss of her sister. Lydia didn't feel sorry for herself. Others suffered far worse. Lydia had learned to adjust. Truth was, she did prefer being awake when everyone else was asleep. There was solace in the still, quiet hours. A form of meditation, which was an odd comparison given what she was doing during that time. Each night, Lydia hit the mean streets to stare in the face of death. She was a detective. Even if her clientele landed a long way from the deep pockets of desirable. The people she investigated were often the ones society shunned, discarded. In the shadows, there was less judgment. Night lacked the urgency of day. This soothed Lydia. What did it matter where you slept if you didn't have a home? Flattened, oil-stained cardboard mattresses made for the same uncomfortable bed regardless. Do we choose our professions, or do they choose us? Lydia thought about this often.
She was thinking about it now, tooling along the freeway, Maureen resting her head against the cool glass, enjoying a power nap after a hearty bowl of pho ap chow zon. Would Lydia have entered the medical profession if Jess hadn't died? Lydia excelled in science classes, biology, anatomy. It was taking home the National Science Prize that caught Maureen and the board's attention. But the field of medicine? Majoring in such a macabre facet? She should have gotten more sleep last night. Thinking wasn't helping. These questions better exhumed in therapy. Entering Old Town, the historic section of Passa Ardo had survived gentrification. Lydia took in the whitewashed windows and boarded-up buildings, feeling the anxiety and dread of darkness creeping in. It was a symptom of her phobia, which is why she chose to be active and outdoors whenever possible. It beat being locked inside a cage. The sun had just set. Enough light left for Lydia not to experience the more debilitating effects of the condition. Plus, she wasn't alone. "You look like you got the weight of the world on your shoulders," Maureen said, coming to, glancing over. Lydia grimaced a smile. Her friend wasn't wrong. Sometimes Lydia felt the weight of it all, unable to withstand the burden, fearful one day she'd be dragged down by the stone. Chapter 2. Then. Night of the protest. Thursday, March 14th, 1991. 9:18 p.m. Jess waited for Sarah and Renee in the dark woods before the cul-de-sac, feeling silly, needlessly clandestine, peeping out between branches. An operative with a price on her head. Better safe than sorry. No reason to risk bright car headlights spreading up the walls, alerting Gloria. Not that a 7.8 quake could rouse Mother from her nightly sleeping pills and bottle of Chardonnay. The street was dark, save for the soft white halo of their porch light. Always a welcoming sight, regardless of the dysfunction swirling inside. There were no streetlights on the road. House so remote. That was the point. Why folks paid big money to live in Passa Ardo. Few neighbors, fewer hassles, most everyone looking, thinking like you. Gazing back at their house, Jess didn't see lights on in any of the guest rooms. It was doubtful her little sister would have returned to their shared bedroom so soon after an argument. Lydia must be asleep. They were sisters. Of course they fought. Sometimes it got bad. This fight was worse, escalating quicker than usual. Jess was turning 18 in a few days. No one that age wants to share a room with their 13-year-old baby sister. Their house was huge with multiple spare rooms, but Lydia was scared of the dark and didn't like to sleep alone. Jess had long acted as caretaker. Mum sure wasn't up to the task. Dad was out in Santa Barbara banging actresses. Jess would be leaving soon. That's what caused the fight. Jess wasn't hiding the acceptance letter from UCLA. She wasn't ready to broadcast the news either. Lydia got the mail first. Jess's decision to attend the University of California, Los Angeles was more nuanced. Lydia couldn't understand. What does a 13-year-old know about true love and soulmates? Panning from dark house to darker street, Jess wished Sarah and Renee would hurry the hell up. She didn't need Lydia waking to pee and noticing she was gone. Her baby sister was nothing if not inquisitive. Crazy smart, too. Probably grow up to be a mathematician or scientist. Jess didn't have time to explain where she was going. Tonight's meeting at the water tower was the start of a revolution. When Lydia stormed from the room, Jess didn't stop her. Her little sister was never short on theatrics. Blame it on hormones or Hollywood, whose reputation loomed large, throwing shade across the valley. They filmed quite a few movies around their little town. Exterior shots of markets or coffee shops. Passa Ardo granting instant, easy access for authentic color and local flavor that couldn't be manufactured on a soundstage. Only the bigger, more commercial movies could afford the assorted fees California tacked on for the luxury of filming on location. Jess knew all about how the movies worked from their father, Alan, who made his name behind the scenes, financing some of the biggest and most profitable. The movies he helped produce were so big that Jess seldom brought it up to friends, even if they were in the theater watching one of them. Felt too much like bragging. Plus, Jess preferred indies, cinema driven by passion and soul instead of bottom-line profit. Jess acknowledged she was biting the hand. Jess and Lydia lived the way they did because of Dad's money. It was hard for Jess to take sides in the divorce. Both her parents were awful. Their mother, Gloria, was one of a kind. You never met a more passive-aggressive, gaslighting bitch in your life. A real piece of work. That's what their dad used to say. He wasn't wrong. Jess appreciated the money her father supplied, even if it was court-ordered. Without it, the girls don't get to keep the big house and privileged Paso Ardo zip code. Then again, if Dad wasn't off screwing prospective talent on casting couches, maybe her parents don't get divorced. Not that they'd been one big happy family when they were together. For two people who had no business being married in the first place, Alan and Gloria Barrett deserved each other. If they hated one another while they were married, Gloria saved the real vitriol for when Dad's career took off after the split, meaning Mom wasn't entitled to as much money, which drove Gloria endlessly irate. That part was amusing, at least. In a way, it screwed Jess and Lydia as well. Except their father was plenty generous with them. Gloria didn't make it easy, wielding her daughters like weapons. Since she had custody, Gloria attached so many strings and stipulations to visitations. Dad often grew weary and gave up. Jess was happy to accept his offer to pay for college. College? The fight. The acceptance letter from UCLA. No matter how many times Jess assured her little sister she'd be back to visit frequently, the university was just over the mountains. Lydia couldn't hide the hurt. Jess understood. She wouldn't want to be left behind with Gloria either. Lydia had already been abandoned by their father. Now, the only stable figure in her life, Jess, was bailing too. We all must follow our own path. Sitting around waiting for her life to begin would only foster animosity. Jess understood that now. Carpe diem. Seize the day. She'd first heard that phrase from Brad, back when he was Mr. Pierce. The hot, young new English teacher, and not the man who changed her world. All the girls were in love with him, but that was because of the way he looked. Jess's attraction sprouted from deeper, more intellectual seeds. Brad was the first teacher to reach Jess, the first to get her to take her studies seriously. After Brad, Jess stopped viewing her father's money as a luxury, and more like a useful resource to harvest the best version of herself. Without Brad, no way Jess turns around a lackluster scholastic career. That's what made Brad so special. He made every student feel like he'd taken a special interest in them. Now it was their turn to return the favor. The wide-open night skies, so clear above the Santa Clarita Valley, exploded with stars. A living planetarium, which only added to how massive this moment felt. Up above, you could see a million distant suns blazing bright, alien worlds lush with the unknown, horizons expanding beyond comprehension. They were going to make big changes in this town. Before the high school hired Brad, Jess hadn't cared about books or learning, period. She had no plans for after high school, no clue what she wanted to do with her life, and was happy to mock anyone trying too hard. Dad's money would allow her to drift from party to party, hanging out with friends, having a good time, letting time pass her by. That was surviving, Brad told her. It wasn't living. Brad introduced her to literature, real literature, not board-approved, boring, canonical crap. He got her to read Dostoevsky, Proust, To Kill a Mockingbird, which she'd been assigned to read several times, never once cracking open the spine. Jess's senior year had coalesced in a series of life-altering events. Cam Rawls and Brad Pierce, embracing learning, falling in love, and a renegade radio show that served as a voice for the voiceless. Tonight was made possible because of the writer. It had started as a joke,
the pirate radio program, because that movie Pump Up the Volume had come out last year. Typical Hollywood misrepresentation of what it was really like to be in high school. All the actors in their 20s and super slick and sexy. Then there was this rider on the plane joker pulling the same stunt. But, like, in a totally ironic way, making fun of that film's earnest message of teen angst. Being judgmental came easy in SoCal. Putting yourself out there left you exposed to ridicule. That was another debt she owed Brad, who was the one who told her, "It's easy to make fun of everything when you don't stand for anything." Whoever this writer was, he'd taken a risk, put himself out there, and had come to represent possibility, hope, and change. The car rounded the corner, headlights off, drifting in neutral, tires rolling over soft sand. Sarah and Renee pulled alongside Jess, sliding up the seat so she could climb in back.
"You ready to do this?" Renee said.
Sarah passed the bottle, Renee checking the rear view as if to make sure they weren't being followed. And even if Jess felt self-conscious at the spy game gesture, she allowed herself to be swept up in the moment and celebrate the cause. Nothing would ever be the same after tonight. Chapter 3. Now. Tuesday, July 19th, 2016. 8:29 p.m. Pulling into the driveway of her childhood home, Lydia spied Richard Fontaine's battered green Ford Ranger pickup truck. Poor guy was a lovesick puppy dog, forever lapping at the heels, desperate to suck at the teat. Floodlights splashed over the courtyard around back, meaning the old guy was still hard at work. Before she even opened the door, Lydia knew where she'd find her mother, lounging, sipping white wine. When she entered the house, Lydia was aware how fast she stepped in front of Maureen, as if to shield her from Gloria's wrath. Gloria, fluffy pink slippered feet propped on the recliner stool, bottle of white on the glass table beside her, peered over her shoulder, scowling. "You remember my friend Maureen?" Lydia said. "You worked together at the morgue." Gloria wrinkled her mouth. "Did you dye your hair darker?" "It's the same color it's always been." Regarding the job, Lydia didn't bother correcting her mother's oversimplification. These were the subtle daggers Gloria excelled at wielding. Her mother's world yielded no nuance. There was no coroner's investigator or medical examiner, only the mindless task of hurting the dead. "How are you, Gloria?" Maureen asked, rising above the slight to extend manners that would not be reciprocated.
"It's nice to see you again."
"I'd be better off if my daughter answered my phone calls." Gloria focused on the giant flat screen. Crime, blood, gore. Some program Lydia had never seen. No surprise. Lydia didn't have much downtime for television. "Mom, we were conducting an autopsy." "I still don't understand why people care so much about how someone dies. Dead is dead. Seems like a waste of taxpayer dollars." Gloria Barrett was not a stupid woman. She recognized the need to determine a cause of death. Legality, bureaucracy, closure for a family. When Jess died, Gloria had been the loudest, most vocal proponent, demanding answers from then-Chief of Police Delmar Rawls. When neither Lydia nor Maureen took the bait, Gloria peeked over her shoulder, nose wrinkled, unsteady eyes angled at her daughter.
"Why didn't you call me back?"
The chastisement was delivered via slight slur. "I told you, I was working this afternoon."
"I thought you worked nights."
"Yes, Mom, I work nights. Sometimes I help out Maureen with autopsies during the day."
"Help?"
Her mother spat the word like an epithet. Her stare remained fixed on Lydia, unwilling to acknowledge anyone else in the room.
"You're not getting enough sleep. You look tired, too dark."
Then to Maureen,
"I hope the county is paying my daughter for all this overtime."
"I personally make sure of it." Maureen smiled. This was the difference between Gloria and Maureen. If the situation were reversed, Gloria would use the platform to push her own agenda.
She'd play the martyr, parlaying abuse to press Lydia to take the assistant ME job. Gloria loved leveraging people against each other. Mo would never manipulate her like that. Gloria's attention returned to the television as she spoke behind her back.
I wish you returned my calls. I left several messages. I'm out of groceries.
Lydia walked into the kitchen, opening the fridge. Every square inch stocked with leafy greens, overpriced soft cheeses, and rare roasted meats. Untouched cartons of oat and almond milk, fresh from the farm eggs at $10 a dozen. Four variations of tamponade whose seal her mother would never break. Mum survived on a liquid diet of rotating herbal smoothies to keep her figure. Lydia gazed through the window, where hunched over Richard Fontaine drove a shovel into the hard earth along the pathway, tearing up chunks of rough terrain in a violent motion, sacks of mulch and slabs of marble piled behind him. Lydia came around to her mother's side. Why didn't you have Richard get groceries for you? Lydia tried to soften the sarcasm. She hated when she sounded like Gloria. There was plenty of food. Groceries was a code for wine.
Dickie's working, Gloria said, oblivious to the setting sun.
You know how late it is? It's dark. There are mountain lions and bobcats out there. The guy is what, 75? 80? Gloria waved a hand.
Dickie likes to keep busy.
You know what they say about the devil and idle hands? Her mother cleared her throat. I'm having him and his boys put in a new walkway to the pool.
Didn't you do that last year?
Yes, I did. But I didn't like it. They used brick. It looked cheap.
I want marble.
Lydia and Maureen exchanged a look. There was no one outside except Richard.
He sent his crew home at 5.
Mum lifted the wine bottle, double-checking it was dry.
Like, they're actual employees. They're trouble, those charity projects of his. I wish he wouldn't bring them here. You know one of them tried to use the bathroom? Inside?
People need to go to the bathroom, Mum.
They can do that elsewhere. I'm not letting those people in my house. They're all crooks.
Maureen touched Lydia's arm with a soft head shake to prevent Lydia's engaging. There was no point checking her mother's racism. That's what it was, plain and simple. Bigotry. For larger projects, Richard used day laborers, who were often Mexican, undocumented immigrants who huddled by designated intersections or outside the Home Depot, hoping to be picked up for $10 an hour. Hardest working people Lydia ever saw, doing the jobs no American wanted, and for a fraction of the cost. Schrodinger's immigrant, both lazy and stealing our jobs. Lydia remembered when Richard first dug the pool in 1990. Back then, the old guy carried a steady crew. She and Jess would sit upstairs by their bedroom window, giggling over shirtless young men slathered in sweat, rough-hewn chiseled bicep and pectoral muscles glistening in the noonday sun. God, her sister was boy crazy.
I liked it when Richard hired our people.
Our people. Lydia was mortified for Maureen's sake. At least her mother didn't say white. Gloria pawed for her wine glass, palsied fingers dancing around the stem.
It's nice to see you, dear,
her mom said without turning around. Revisiting a childhood home is a bizarre experience. You get older, but the house never changes. Maybe a metal sculpture is erected on the porch. A burnished sign gets hung over the doorway. A new portrait goes up in the hall. But at its core, the house remains the same, retaining what it has always been. It's you who has changed, altering perception. Since Lydia last visited 2 months ago, the family room had been painted a more soothing shade of taupe. With each visit, the home felt smaller, regardless of its thousands of square feet or sizable acreage it sat on. The space could no longer contain Lydia, like Alice popping pills, forever shrinking. By many standards, the home was a mansion. In Paso Ardo, it was par for the course. An apt comparison with the country club up the road, cresting the hill, sucking up precious water high in demand, short in supply.
90 million gallons a year. Lydia had read that somewhere.
If you'd call ahead, Gloria said, I would have made extra for dinner.
Lydia didn't need to mention she and Mo had already eaten. The statement was absurd. Gloria didn't cook. Anytime she did eat solid food, it was delivered. Unless she had Richard grill salmon. Lydia stepped into the living room, Maureen lingering in the kitchen. Nearing Gloria, Lydia studied the TV screen. A dramatic recreation depicted a gruesome murder. Index cards encircling blood splatter. What are you watching?
Netflix. Documentary. Serial killer. They always recommend these shows.
I let them play. Surprise me. All these programs are the same.
So sensational.
The remote rested by Gloria's hand. She could change the channel anytime she wanted. Her mother pushed herself to her feet, making the effort to appear greater than it was. As her mother came nearer, Gloria's face seemed unnaturally taut, stretched with recent injections. The doctors used a heavy pour this time. Her skin looked like it had been sealed in plastic wrap. Gloria leaned in, brushing Lydia's skin, kissing air.
It's good to see you, dear, she repeated, patting her daughter on the shoulder, making for the kitchen.
At the pantry, Mum brought back a warm bottle of Chardonnay, reaching for the freezer and ice.
Seen your father lately?
We had dinner last month.
Dinner?
Her mother spat.
How's Heather?
Still prancing around half-dressed? Gloria never hid her disdain for Alan's wife. Heather was an actress, if not a terribly successful one. She was one of her father's many affairs. Lydia didn't know why this one stuck. The age difference was off-putting at first. Still, when Jess was missing, Heather, only 25 at the time, had been far more supportive than Gloria had ever been. Richard came in through the back door, eyes lighting up, crow's feet crinkling with kindness.
Lydia!
He came in for a hug, stopping short, staring down at his dirty hands and stained shirt, settling on a pleasant smile to avoid soiling her clean clothes.
What have you been up to?
He asked. Work. Lydia broke into a grin. You remember Maureen?
How could I forget?
Richard beamed like a proud dad.
She's been grooming you for the big time half your life.
What's Mom got you doing these days? Lydia asked, dodging the subject of becoming full-time medical examiner.
Oh, you know, this and that.
Richard smiled, thumbing over his shoulder.
We're sprucing up the pool, he pointed at the sky. I was installing motion sensor lights.
Right. The crime rate in Paso Ardo. Lydia smiled. Good to see you're keeping busy. He laughed.
Back barks nonstop.
Richard reached for his lower lumbar.
I'm like a shark. Gotta keep moving to stay alive.
Will you be spending the night? Gloria asked her daughter. Your old room is as you left it.
Mom, I told you I have to work. There was no need to point out she'd come with Maureen. The offer was perfunctory. Gloria liked knowing she could demand Lydia's presence. Didn't mean she wanted her staying long.
I thought you worked earlier.
Yes, I assisted Maureen with an autopsy. I still have my night shift. Gloria cast her eyes warily over both women.
I don't get it. All those years of medical school. For what?
Examining dead bodies?
How is that a real doctor?
Real doctors save lives.
They don't dissect them like frogs in biology class.
Maureen had too much class to respond. And Lydia, as she did with most of the offensive things that came out of her mother's mouth, let it be.
I guess I'll go to bed, Gloria said. Nice to see you again, Maureen.
Gloria couldn't have said it with any less sincerity.
Too bad you have to leave, Lydia,
she added, glancing toward Richard, laying the bricks of the guilt trip to come.
Dickie will be going soon. I get so lonely in this big house, and I only have one daughter.
Chapter 4. Then, random weekend after the divorce became final. 1989. Late morning.
A 15-year-old experiences a parent's divorce differently than an 11-year-old does. Whereas an older sister might embrace peace after years of endless warfare, the younger one only sees her world falling apart. Late Saturday morning, Jess was supposed to be hanging out at the mall, but called her friends to bail. Jess decided to stay home with Lydia after her baby sister spent the night crying in the closet. Their father, Alan, was coming by today to pick up the rest of his stuff, which had been boxed and gathered for easy pickup, meaning he could have sent a messenger service or any of his lackeys to fetch these items, which were frivolous anyway, at least compared to the grief of his own children. A charity raffled guitar signed by Bruce Springsteen, an artist he didn't like, a set of old golf clubs for a sport he seldom played, records for the player he didn't own. Jess would have loved to believe their dad wanted the opportunity to see his daughters. That wasn't it. Alan wasn't a bad father. He loved his girls. He was kind and gentle, but never present. If he could be elsewhere, Jess got the impression he would be. Alan, who produced movies, cheated on Gloria. Normally, that would make a girl like Jess side with Mom. But you didn't know Gloria. Watching the way Gloria treated their dad, her sense of entitlement, the way their mom treated her new boyfriend, Richard, just thought he was a boyfriend, how she treated everyone, but men in particular, like they were born to serve her, was sickening. This didn't excuse her father's affairs. Even at 15, Jess could see how those affairs happened. Yes, there was opportunity. Alan didn't work on straight-to-video production. He helped finance major motion pictures, box office record breakers, Academy Award nominees, winners. Actresses had been throwing themselves at him. Maybe their dad was a sleazeball. What did Jess know about adult relationships? She'd look around at her friend's parents, half of whom were divorced. Few spoke kindly to each other. In the middle was a math equation that didn't add up. Two oddball parents who actually enjoyed one another's company. Waiting for Dad to show up, Jess watched Richard with his makeshift construction crew break ground on the new deluxe in-ground pool. Gloria had her lawyer tack it on in the divorce settlement, because she could. Mother delighted in extracting every bloody red cent she could. Gloria didn't like to swim. It would be wonderful to say she got the pool for her daughters. Lydia might believe that. Jess knew better. The pool was going to be nice, though. Jess had seen the plans. Of course, her mother picked the most expensive options, only to turn around and have her boyfriend Richard do the labor on the cheap. Jess had to stop calling him that. Gloria didn't treat Richard like a boyfriend. But boy, did that guy love her. You should have seen it. Old man Richard lifting heavy sacks of concrete, buckling his knees, hunching his back. You couldn't help but root for the guy. Jess didn't remember when Richard entered their lives. The handyman always seemed to be around. Didn't matter if today was a weekend. Jess knew Gloria instructed Richard to be there, because she wanted Alan to see she too had moved on. Gloria sashayed around the kitchen in a silk robe, clutching her morning Bloody Mary. Every time she passed the sliding glass patio doors, she let a shoulder slip, taunting the men outside. Gloria was pretty. Jess knew having Richard there was part of a plan. But if that plan was to make their father jealous, Gloria ought to have picked a better boy toy than a battered, bent, and broken Richard Fontaine. Perhaps since Richard had worked for the family while they were married, Gloria wanted Alan to believe he wasn't the only one getting some on the side. Lydia, glasses crooked, bed-headed hair, rounded the corner, wiping her nose with a pajama sleeve, before reaching for cereal in the cupboard.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.